Hello, dear learners, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Jaseem Ahmed from IAC, Faculty of Education, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. Today, we will discuss the topic, Psychology of Learning and Development, its evolutionary view, neuroscience perspective, and humanistic theory. This comes under the paper, Psychology of Learning and Development. So, dear students, the objectives of this module are: number one, to discuss the history of the development of learning. Number two, to describe the evolutionary view of psychology of learning and development. Number three, to describe the neuroscience perspective of learning and development. And the last one is to describe humanistic theory of learning and development. Dear students, ability of learning is one of the most important features of human being. Human beings have been endowed with the unique capability of thinking, reasoning, imagination, logic, and all other potentialities that are carried out by humans only. This capability is possessed by human beings because they possess the highly developed brain having the above said potentialities. In addition to these God-gifted potentials, human beings have some other needs and emotions which make them the human beings. All these potentialities make them able to teach, learn, and develop accordingly. Here, in this module, we will present the evolution of psychology of learning and development, the neuroscience perspective of learning and development, and the humanistic approach to learning. Now, we will discuss about evolution of psychology of learning and development. Dear students, the origin and evolution of modern psychology of learning can be traced to the work of Hermann Ebbinghaus. 1850 to 1909, he published his well-known work on memory in 1885. Other early works in the area of learning were done by Edward L. Thorndike, 1874 to 1949, who published his dissertation on problem solving in 1898, and also by Ivan P. Pavlov, 1849 to 1936, who began research in classical conditioning in 1899. And published his work in English language in 1927. These theories focused on explaining the behavior using a stimulus response pattern in the process of learning. They were termed as behavioral theories and dominated psychology and education for almost half a century. As these behavioral theories focused on environmental factors, they conceptualized learning as something that occurs from the outside. Now, it is to be seen that behavioral theories show dual nature. On one hand, these provide good explanation for certain kinds of learning, but on the other hand, give poor explanations for some other types of learning. For example, operant conditioning is better than other theories in explaining the acquisition of information through rote memorization, learning of skills, and the development of behaviors of children. In such learning situation, the focus is on performing behavioral tasks rather than developing learner's cognitive structure or understanding. Classical conditioning of Pavlov provides by far the best explanation of how and why people respond emotionally to a wide variety of stimulus and situations. Various types of emotional reactions, such as anger towards a person, hatred for a person or group, phobias to a specific subject or situation are acquired through classical conditioning. However, students, these theories are very poor in explaining the phenomena of understanding complex ideas by individuals. Factors other than environment which influenced learning entered mainstream psychological thinking during the 1960s. For example, learning by observation and a learner's belief about his or her ability to perform a task, that is self-efficacy, play an important role in their learning came into the center of discussion. In 1963, Albert Bandura and R. H. Walters published their social learning theory, which has clear roots in behavioral theory but is different from these theories in significant ways. 1980s, the social learning theory developed into social cognitive theory in its refined form. Now it can be noticed that the conception and definition of learning began to change very fast during the 1970s and 1980s. Behavioristic theories gave way to cognitive theories, which focus on the use of mental operations and activities and the process of understanding. In this way, learning shifted from stimulus response framework to information processing metaphor. A new understanding developed that learning occurs from the inside out rather than from the outside in. During the 1970s, John Flavel and Anne Brown began to study metacognition, that is, learners' awareness of their own learning. It is the ability of learners to reflect on their own thinking and the capability to monitor and manage their learning by themselves. During the later 1980s and 1990s, the cognitive theories began to face challenges from other theories who emphasized the importance of social interaction in the process of learning. The work of the Russian psychologist Lev Vygotsky, 1896 to 1934, along with the work of anthropologists such as Jean Lev, began to have major influence on theories of learning. The notion that people learn by observing others first articulated in social cognitive theory and was expanded in a new context. See, conventionally, learning has been considered as something which occurs within an individual, but now many psychologists and educators believe learning to be a phenomenon that is distributed among several individuals and related environmental affordances, or situated within a community of practice or community of learners. According to P. 1993, both the social and material dimension is involved in this distribution. For example, a learner may use a rubber ball to help himself learn about the third law of motion regarding action and reaction. In this example, the rubber ball is material dimension. He may work with others, like friends or society, to understand the third law of motion and how it works in different life activities. The interaction with other individuals may be referred to as the social dimension. See, in both the cases, the student is not learning totally on his own, but is taking advantage of either resources, that is affordances, or other individuals available in the environment. Dear learners, the evolution of learning theories from behavioral to social, social to distributed, and distributed to situated accompanied new conception of knowledge at all stages. Traditional theories conceive knowledge as a commodity which can be transmitted, more or less intact, from one person to another, but now it is not so. According to earlier theories, knowledge is something a person acquires. When a person successfully learns it, he or she can reproduce the knowledge in its original form. Contrary to this, recent theories conceive knowledge as something that each learner constructs afresh on his own rather than something that is assimilated in its pre-existing form. As per the current theories, true or objective knowledge does not exist. Although something similar exists in the form of collective knowledge within a particular culture or discipline. Students, knowledge resides in the community of learners that creates it and is distributed among members of the community and the various environmental affordances available to the group. Because each person constructs his or her own understanding, the knowledge they acquire is unique. Dear students, now we will talk about neuroscience perspective of learning and development. The decade of 1990s was dubbed as the decade of brain, where huge advances were made in neurosciences which explain how brain relates to behavior and learning. An understanding of how the neurophysiology of the brain affects learning and cognition will add greatly to our understanding of human learning and have a large influence on future theories of learning. Human beings are genetically equipped with the cranial gadgets of learning. It is not a prosthetic device. When it comes to the brain, a lump of neural tissues, we do frequently assume it to be not just an extension of other lump, but something quite unique. It has a psyche which makes a difference between us and the animals. Brain is an organ, and mind is the function of that organ. The best analogy would be that the human brain, the neural structure, can be compared to computer hardware and mind to the software. There are different areas in human brain performing specific functions. For example, the cerebellum coordinates and orchestrates balance and smooth skill movement. It also plays a role in higher cognitive functions such as learning. The hippocampus is critical in recalling new information and recent experiences, while the amygdala directs emotions. The thalamus is involved in our ability to learn new information, particularly verbal. The reticular formation plays a role in attention and arousal and blocking some messages and sending others on to higher brain centers for processing. The corpus callosum moves information from one side of the brain to the other. The cerebral cortex is the largest area of the brain with about 85% of the brain's weight in adulthood and contains the greatest number of neurons, the unit of neurotransmission. The cerebral cortex is involved in the complex problem-solving functions and in language. It serves three major tasks. Number one, receiving signals from sense organs. Number two, controlling voluntary movement. Number three, forming association. According to Gowda, 2010, the cortex is the last part of the brain to develop. So, it is believed to be more susceptible to environmental influences as compared to the other parts of the brain. While talking about neuroscience, it is important to discuss certain points like development of brain, development of cerebral cortex, and a specialization and integration of brain. Let's talk about development of brain first. Human brain starts developing after about 1 month of conception. Brain constitutes the center of the nervous system. The unit of the nervous system is neuron, nerve cells that store and transfer information. The neurons send messages to each other by releasing chemicals that jump across the tiny spaces called synapses between the dendrites of one neuron and the axon of other neurons. Stimulation is important for both development and learning. Studies on animals by Greeno, Black and Wallace 1987 have shown that rats raised in stimulating environments develop 25% more synapses than rats who are raised with little stimulation. Early stimulation is important among humans as well. As per Byrnes and Fox, 1998, and Cobb and Wishaw, 1998, it is clear that extreme deprivation of stimulation can have negative effects on brain development. But extra stimulation will not necessarily improve development for young children who are getting adequate or typical amounts of stimulation. Hence, spending on expensive toys or baby education programs probably provides more stimulation than it is required. Severe stimulus deprivation at early stage can have lasting impact on the developing brain of the child. By using some compensation, deprivation damage can be overcome. Besides stimulus deprivation, many factors such as mother's intake of drug, alcohol, caffeine during pregnancy, presence of toxin in the infant's environment, such as late paint or poor nutrition to the child, can have direct and dramatic negative effects on brain development of children. Myelination is another factor that influences thinking and learning of children. It is the coating of neuron fibers with an insulating fatty covering. This is like covering of bare electric wires with plastic. It not only provides safety, but efficiency in electrical conductivity as well. Similarly, this myelin coating makes information transmission faster and more efficient. Myelination happens quickly in the early years of children, but continues gradually into adolescence. This is the reason the child's brain grows rapidly in size in the first few years of life. After having deliberated on the development of brain, now let's discuss the development of cerebral cortex. It develops more slowly than other parts of the brain. Different parts of cerebral cortex mature at different times. It controls physical motor movement, sense such as vision and hearing, and its frontal lobe controls higher order thinking processes. the temporal lobes of the cortex play major roles in emotions. According to Weinberger, 2004, it takes at least 2 decades to produce a fully functional prefrontal cortex of the brain. This is the reason that middle and high school students still lack the brain development to balance impulse with reason and planning. Having aware of this fact, parents and teachers may be suggested to loan their children a prefrontal cortex by helping them set rules and limits and make plans until the child's own prefrontal cortex is developed. Now, let's talk about the specialization and integration of the brain. According to Byron and Fox, 1998, to accomplish more complex functions such as speaking or reading, the various areas of the cortex must work together. For example, many areas of the cortex are necessary in processing language. Like to answer a question, we must first hear it. This involves the primary auditory cortex. Movements controlled by the motor cortex are required to speak our responses. A specialization of the two hemispheres of brain is another aspect of brain functioning that has implication for cognitive development. It is known that each half of the brain affects movement of their opposite half side of the body. So, we can say that damage to the right side of the brain affects movement of the left side of the body and vice versa. In addition, certain areas of the brain affect our particular behaviors. For example, the left hemisphere of the brain is a major factor in our language processing, and the right hemisphere handles much of the spatial visual information and emotions, that is, the non-verbal informations. The right side of the brain is better at figuring out the meaning of a story. The left side is where grammar and syntax are understood. In this way, both sides of the brain have to work together in reading. Hence, we must provide such educational opportunities to children that have all kinds of activities for a balanced development of all parts of brain. Now, let's move to the last objective of this module, that is the humanistic perspective. The humanistic theory of learning is the result of the third force movement, which in turn is based on the ideology of existentialist philosophers such as Martin Heidegger, Soren Kierkegaard, Nicholas Bardeev, Carl Jaspers, Martin Buber, Gabriel Marcel, Wilhelm Tilthe, Jacques Maritain, Jean-Paul Sartre, and George Kelly, etc. Humanistic psychology focuses on the importance of physiological and instinctual influences on personality and emphasizes individual growth to reach total realization of the vast potential, taking into consideration the needs and inner urge of the individuals. According to this view, as explained by Goda, 2010, learning is an active process of reconstructing knowledge driven by the learner's inner urges and needs. While discussing about the humanistic perspective, we cannot miss to talk about the hierarchy of needs given by Maslow. In Maslow's view, human needs can be arranged in a hierarchy, an ordered sequence in which higher and more abstract needs emerge only when the more basic ones have been either fully or partially met. He differentiates between basic needs and meta needs. Basic needs are primary or biological in nature, such as the need for air, food, protection from danger, and familiarity with environment. Meta needs transcends these basic needs and involve a personal reaching or growing to realize one's potential. These meta needs include such things as belongingness, esteem, and aesthetic fulfillment. According to Maslow, they are necessary to help us become self-actualized persons. That is, persons who are realistically oriented, autonomous, and creative. Only liberated persons can be creative and can reach self-actualization. Dear students, self-actualization here means developing one's potential to its optimum level, impelled by the desire to achieve more and more what he or she is capable of achieving. Although self-actualization appears to be the ultimate on Maslow's hierarchy of needs, he talks about self transcendence, that is, the need to express tangibly concern for others. Analogous to Maslow's theory of personality development is the ancient Indian concept of development given in the Taittiriya Upanishad, which describes the human personality in terms of ascendance through panchkosh. These are, number one, annamaya kosh, that is the development of physique that has been nurtured by food. Number two, pranamaya kosh, that is functions expressed through breaths. Number three, manomaya kosh, that is development of feeling and emotions. Number four, vignamaya kosh, that is development of reason and intellect. Number five is anandamaya kosh, that is transcendence and altruism, that is development of thinking above narrow limits of self and material world. To Maslow, the goal of a theory of motivation should be to unite the biological perspective of early motivation theory with a more humanistic appraisal of social motives. He argued that some motivations are more basic than others, and that more basic ones must be satisfied before other forms of motivation begin to operate. In this way, he hoped not merely to classify biological, that is basic, and social, that is meta needs, but to show how each relates to the others. Although Maslow sometimes referred to this hierarchy as a developmental sequence, he did not mean to imply that once the lower needs have been met, they are forever replaced by the higher ones. Maslow's theory is not empirically based, hence not testable, but more humanistic and comprehensible. It is a personality theory. In some way, it is surprisingly consistent with the earlier thoughts of Thorndike and Hull, that is, individual perform in a positive way if that performance leads to the satisfaction of their needs. Other than Maslow, Carl Rogers was another pioneer of humanistic psychology. Carl Rogers' theory of client-centered therapy and non-directive counseling, which was given in 1951, has more of an affective dimension than a cognitive one. The focus is away from teaching and shifted towards learning. A person is to be treated as a whole person. In his or her transaction with the subject matter, the learner engages as a whole person, not partial in terms of cognitive or conative or affective aspects. And as a result, learning becomes holistic and a personal matter. Humanistic psychologists helped us to see learning as the main process of meeting the compulsion of inner urges and drives, rather than responding to external stimuli as behaviorists believe, or meeting the demands of new knowledge as maintained by cognitivists. Humanistic psychologists uphold the dignity and freedom of the individual learners and maintain that the learner, instead of getting controlled by the externals, that is, the content, quantum of knowledge, environmental stimuli, and the like, actually controls the externals. The choice is of learners, but they must be free to do that. In the process of constant transaction with the external world, learners change the body of knowledge and also gets themselves changed internally. According to Naylor, 1971, much of the ills of our present day classroom can be ascribed to the problem of alienation or distancing. Alienation is an existential concept. The teacher is alienated himself. He does not exist as a real person in the classroom. He is a core doer, a role player, and he acts according to top-down instructions. He is alienated from his subject matter, and it is outside himself. The teacher is also alienated from pupils. The remedy for this problem may be found in Martin Buber's 1965 Perception of Dialogue. Teaching, according to him, cannot be a true dialogue if the teacher is considered an instructor, a supplier of information, one who simply mediates between the pupil and the subject matter. In a dialogue situation, the teacher and pupil meet as equal person in terms of humanity, individual worth, and dignity. As mentioned by Gowda, 2010, they share the same object of knowing and engage in personal dialogue and discussion, constantly interrogating one another. Students, now let's first talk about the goal and principles of humanistic education. Humanistic education believe in developing fully functional, self-actualized human beings who have the capacity to nurture themselves, others, and their environment, who are responsible global citizens and are able to contribute to democratic societies, and who are lifelong learners. Let's talk about the five principles of humanistic education which support and help in achieving the above mentioned goal. These are: number one, principle of self-direction; number two, principle of relevancy of the subject matter; number three, principle of inclusion of full spectrum of the human experience within the curriculum; number four, principle of producing students who want to learn and know how to learn; number five, principle of providing non-threatening environment. We shall discuss all the principles in detail, starting from the first one, that is the principle of self-direction. Friends, learning should be as self-directed as much as possible. Students should be given the opportunities and choices about what they learn, how they learn, and how they reflect and demonstrate on their learning. One must understand that choice does not mean total choice all the time. It means a student's choice must be taken into consideration as far as possible. Choice may be represented on a continuum. At one end, no choice at all, and at the other end, total choice at all time. Between these two extremes, there exists a variety of ways students can make their choices about their learning. For example, a teacher can offer, number one, no choice. Boys and girls, we are studying the Civil War this month. This is the book we are going to read. This is the topic you will be doing reports on. A choice within a set. Boys and girls, I have put out five books for you. You can choose the one you wish to read. A choice within a category. Boys and girls, we are studying the Civil War this month. You can read any book or investigate any topic related to the Civil War. Total choice. Students, find a topic that interests and inspires you for your project. Some students for situation require more choice, some requires less choice. The goal should be to provide the least restrictive environment for learning. This means having the minimum amount of control necessary to create a conducive environment for learning and providing positive learning experiences. Moving to the second principle mentioned earlier, that is principle of relevancy of the subject matter. Dear students, the subject matter of learning should be relevant to the personal interest of the learners. It must be integrated to their daily lives or interest to the greatest extent possible. Teachers need to be creative in connecting content with the previous experiences of the learners, especially daily life activities. There needs to be a space within the curriculum where the students may explore topics of their interest. For example, adolescents are extremely interested in topics related to social experiences, relationships, career talks, and identifying self in terms of values and future roles or occupations. Such themes and topics can be included within a variety of subject areas with a little creativity and imagination to draw their attention and interest. We should keep in mind that curriculum is made for students. Students are not for curriculum. Switching to the third principle, which is principle of inclusion of full spectrum of the human experience within the curriculum. Dear students, there is a need to include full spectrum of the human experiences into the educational experience given to the learners. Human experience includes emotions, relationships, creativity, imagination, intuition, and all real life problems faced by individuals and society. Inclusion of these into the educational experience enhances learning. In classes, teachers should not only teach the topics, but they should also provide a greater context for that knowledge. For example, how that particular content being taught impacts students' personal lives, how it impacted other human beings around them and the society as a whole. The next is the principle of producing students who want to learn and know how to learn. Dear students, schools should produce students who want to learn and know how to learn. Humans have the natural potential an inclination to find out their world. Learning things of interest is a natural tendency of human being. We suppress and kill off this natural instinct when we regularly put out students to learn those things which have no relevance to their lives, or we fail to make them understand their connection with their lives. It also happens when we ask them to learn in the ways that are not natural and interesting to them. Students, the fifth and the last principle we need to discuss is principle of providing non-threatening environment. Threats may be in various forms such as physical, social, emotional and economical that endanger one's self-esteem. These threats may come from various sources. It may be a teacher, peer group, society and physical environment within and out of a school, especially in the way from home to school or school to home. A school should be a pleasant and threat-free place of learning where students can use and express all their potential boldly. Now we move towards the last theme of this module, that is the humanistic teacher. Under humanistic theory, teaching starts with a sound relationship with the students. Carl Rogers in 1969 describes three key conditions for learning, which are number one, respect, number two, empathetic understanding, and number three, genuineness. Talking about respect, dear students, teacher should respect each student without making any difference among them. Roger calls this as unconditional positive regard. Every teacher should accept every student unconditionally, no matter who they are and from where they belong to. This respect for students helps to promote their own self-respect and sense of self-efficacy, which in turn enhance learning. Next, as mentioned earlier, is empathetic understanding, which talks that a teacher should be able to see things from the learner's point of view. For every step, every decision, every suggestion, every remarks that the teacher is going to give to the child, the teachers must place him or she in learner's place before making the choice for them. Because we as teachers know what it feels like to be excited, lost, confused, frustrated, curious, anxious, confident, or bored. We know very well how it feels like to have a teacher who cares for students and who is vigorously trying for the learners to succeed in learning and in life. And the last one, as told by Rogers, was genuineness. Genuine teachers don't have to rely on methods or techniques. Rather, they can trust their own emotions and experiences to guide them. They can devise their own methods to make their students learn. It doesn't mean that research-based strategies developed by the experts are not important. Instead, genuine teachers act as a researcher. And whenever need arises, they develop innovative techniques to deal with the topic and children. Availability of these conditions enhances academic learning and intellectual development of the teacher as well as learners. So, students, today we talked about humanistic learning theory, which advocates that education should focus on human development and personal growth. According to humanistic learning theory, humans have a natural tendency to learn, grow, and develop fully. Education works best when it is aligned with humans' natural needs and tendencies. Humanistic learning theory is much based on humanism. Activities related to humanistic learning, when correctly implemented, complement and enhance all forms of academic learning and growth. Hence, dear learners, let's apply all the theories and approaches of learning in the classroom situation to improve the quality of learning outcomes in a specific and quality of education in general. Thank you so much for today.